Well, good morning. On this rather wet day for Bermuda, and wintry almost, warm welcome to you all. Warm welcome to any visitors today, and any new. Delighted to say, you may have already noticed, we've got two new members of the choir. A warm welcome to them and to all. And as always, after our worship this morning, the tea and coffee will actually be served in the Thorburn Hall rather than outside. You're probably quite glad to. If I don't linger, it's nothing to do with the fact that Scotland are playing France in Paris. Kickoff's 11 o'clock. Notices. You'll see that on Saturday, first of all, on Tuesday is the first of our Lenten services today, the first Sunday in Lent, and during Lent, the Warwick Alliance of Churches organises Lenten services on the Tuesday evening, and the first one is this Tuesday evening. It's in the New Testament Church of God on Cedar Hill. That's at 7:30, and there will be services every Tuesday evening. And then on Saturday, it's actually March the 4th, it's Messy Church. So that's on Saturday. And you'll see there's an insert there. It's 5 to 6:30. Fun, family, food and faith, all welcome. So on this, the first Sunday of Lent, let us worship God in singing to his praise from the Psalms and at hymn number 4, how excellent in all the earth, Lord our Lord, is thy name. Because Jesus himself has passed through the test of suffering, he is able to help those who are in the midst of their test. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather this day to offer you our worship and our praise. We join with your whole church in heaven and on earth. People of different nations, backgrounds, histories, and cultures, but united and the desire to acknowledge you as creator and as sustainer of all life. O gracious God, we come together in this season of Lent, the 40 days of Lent, as they reflect the 40 days in the wilderness, the 40 days of the flood, a time of reflection, a time of reflecting on your being, your nature, and your ways, and what it is that you ask of us. And as we do so, we reflect that we have not always lived as we should. We have been selfish and self-centered, rebellious, lacking in our faith, going the way of a rebellious world rather than following the paths down which you call us. And in so doing, we have caused harm to ourselves, harm to others, and indeed harm to the very creation of which we are but a part. And so before you now, we ask forgiveness. Forgiveness for the wrong that we have done and the hurt that we have caused. And as we ask your forgiveness, we ask too the forgiveness and the patience of those whom we have let down. Grant us, we pray, the assurance of your forgiveness that we may be freed from the faults and the failings and the guilt of the past. In this season of Lent, a time of waiting, a time of reflection, a time of journeying, as we journey with Christ himself from his ministry in Galilee to Jerusalem and to his crucifixion there, his teaching of the disciples, and all that he teaches us still today. Help us to listen again to his words, to learn from him, and to follow him in faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Right, before they go off to CCY, a word with our youngsters. We're going to be reading shortly a couple of passages, one from what's probably called the Old Testament, but is really better known nowadays as the Hebrew Scriptures, the Scriptures of the Jewish people, and another one from the New Testament. And the one from the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, is right at the beginning, right? It's in chapter 2. And it's a sentence from that simply says this: "The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it." Now, when we read that, it is just the man, because the woman hasn't been created yet, right? It's just the man, and it's only after this that he thinks, oh, it'd be a good job for the man to have company, and so woman is created. Now, let me share with you that the writers of this, right? The writers of this, and it was a long time ago, but the writers of this didn't for a moment believe that human beings started with two people, right? They never thought that for a minute. When you look at the language in which it was written, the Hebrew, it simply stands for, if you like, humanity, right? Human beings. So when it says he created the man and put him in the garden, and then later he created the woman, he never, say, for a moment thought that all of us started from just two people. But the writers of this were very thoughtful and insightful people. And when we read these passages, the passage of creation and all that follows in the next chapters, there's so much in there which is fascinating and still important and interesting for today. And it's a pity. I give you this warning now, right? It's a pity as you get a little bit older and you go into high school and you start doing science and all the rest of it, that you come back to this and you think, nah, none of that's right. The universe is billions of years old and has evolved over that long, long time. And it's a great pity if youngsters like yourself do that and they say, nah, it's none of that's true, and miss out all the truth that's actually within it. And today's truth is quite a simple one, isn't it? The Lord God took the man, human beings, and put them in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. To keep it. And what that teaches, what that was trying to teach, was that human beings were just part of the wonder of creation, the beauty of the country, of the world. The world, as we know it, the planet Earth, the oceans, the mountains, the plains, the deserts, this lovely island on which we live. It just simply says we're put there to care for it and to look after it. And that was written thousands of years ago. And yet we sometimes still do not take that to heart, do we? We so easily spoil it. I think I'm right in saying this is the season for the whales passing by Bermuda, isn't it? Is that right? I ask you because I haven't seen any yet, right? So I don't know. Maybe they're late or maybe I'm not sure. Anyway. But these beautiful creatures, these wonderful creatures, the whales, and yet in years past, they were hunted till we almost wiped them out. And we do that with other animals as well, and we spoil the creation. So that's today's lesson for you. And it's nice to think that it's very often young people today that are leading the charge in that and saying, come on. Past generations have not looked after the world and its creatures as they should have done. And we really need to start doing that. And there it is. Right, there it is, thousands of years ago. The Lord God took the man and the woman and all humanity and put them in this garden, this beautiful creation, and said, look after it. Okay. A word of blessing on our children. Loving God, as our children go from here, may they go with your blessing and at all times in their lives know your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Before you go out, I tell you, why don't you stay for this next hymn? It's a lovely hymn about creation. It's hymn 243, Touch the Earth Lightly. And then when it's finished, you can slip out. 243.
Good morning. The first reading is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, followed by Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 to 7. Chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." And continuing, beginning of chapter 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. But God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The gospel reading for today is from Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11, the temptation of Jesus. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against the stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to them, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him.
May God bless us, the reading of his word, and to him his name be the praise and the glory. Amen. Hymn 338 to the tune Blainworm. Hymn 338.
Thank you.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So the traditional readings for the first Sunday in Lent, the reading of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness and the accompanying story of the Garden of Eden and the man and the woman, or should I say the woman and then the man, taking of the forbidden fruit. I'm going to reflect mainly today on the temptations of Jesus, but it's rightly said that in a way you cannot read the story of what is too often referred to as the fall, which is probably not the best description for it, because what it really describes is human beings' rebelliousness, and indeed creation's rebelliousness against God. But it's often been said, and rightly said, that you can't simply read that in church and not comment on it. And that's partly because of the history of the ways in which this particular passage has been used in the really wrongful treatment of women. I felt uncomfortable reading it myself. You know, that bit where it says Eve offers Adam the forbidden fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And this phrase kept coming into my mind. That I would say to, I have said on numerous occasions to Judy, and for those who perhaps, so that's my wife, the too often occasions when I have said, I don't know why I listen to you. Now, in my partial defense, and it is only partial, it's only always when we're in the car, right? And it's, do you think we go left or right here, right? And I know what I think it is. I think it's right. And Judy says it's left. And 5 minutes later, I don't know why I ever listened to you. Okay, so that's a kind of a trivial example. But it has to be said that over the centuries, this passage of pinning all the blame on Eve and on women for the wrongs of the world, it was all their fault, is a complete utter misreading of the passage, and that always needs to be kept in mind. In fact, there is so much in this passage, and they say about the rebelliousness that it talks about. I mean, have you ever pondered the fact, you know, Paul talks about sin coming into the world through Adam and Eve? Have you ever pondered the crafty serpent? What was he about? I mean, he was the original rebellious creature, and all that shows is that rebellion, if you like, sin, rebellion's a better word. Rebellion is just inherent, it's endemic in creation. It's just part of the created realm. It rebels, the whole of creation, of which we are but a part, rebels against God. And we'll perhaps come back to that. And so the temptations of Jesus in the desert, it's rather tragic that just recently a young African preacher died trying to fast for 40 days, not just without food, but largely without water. By the time his family were able to get him to hospital, it was too late. The damage had been done to his body and he passed away. Tragic that he should be attempting to do that. I mean, the 40 days, as reflected in the opening prayer, it's a favorite number in scriptures. You know, the flood lasted, the rains lasted 40 days and nights, and then the wandering in the wilderness was for 40 years. And when Moses went up Mount Sinai before he got the commandments, he was 40 days. You know, so 40 is, it just means a long time. It just means a long time. But Jesus, we're told, certainly went and fasted, or took himself off, or was taken off into the wilderness. And see, what's so tragic about anyone trying to say, well, I'll try and replicate this, I'll do the 40 days, is that it's not a one-off event, right? It's not like sitting your driving test, okay? And you pass the test, you get through the test, And then you stop putting the handbrake on every time you stop at a stop sign, right? And you steer with one hand and all the rest of it. It's not like that, right? It's not always passed the test, now we can put that behind him. And no, it's something that was with him throughout his entire ministry. It's just explained and symbolized here, the temptations, the tests, the temptations that with which he was faced. So I want to ask you this. Have any of you ever felt tempted? Right? Any of you? I asked the question because I don't think I have really myself. Yeah, so I just thought I'd ask some of you, you know, to get a different sense of experience. Have any of you ever felt tempted? I mean, come on, just if you have. Let me see again, because quite a number. No. Stephen. I mean, is this something you'd like to share? Or no, right. Well, when I say, you know, I don't really think I've felt terribly tempted. I'm going to try and explain to you why. This is not about giving up chocolate or being tempted by chocolate or anything else. This story of the temptation is a profound, profound story, and something from which, in many respects, I think most of us are actually spared, but not completely. And to understand the strength of it, we need to go back to the verse before. And remember, when we read the story, this is Matthew's account of the temptation, which in fact is slightly different from Luke's. And Mark simply said he was tempted in the wilderness. So we go back to how the previous chapter finishes. And it finishes with the account of Jesus' baptism. And these words, "A voice from heaven said, 'This is my son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased.'" This is my son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. And then we're told that Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where he's encountered with this question: "If you are the Son of God, then turn these stones into bread." And that's the sense of it, right? This is my son, with whom I am well pleased. And the response of the world, if you like, and the rebellions of the world. Well, if that's true, if you are the Son of God, then what about it? What about doing this? And what is it that he's invited to do? And it's been described as a story, in a sense, of about power and presumption. If you are the Son of God, what powers are available to you? And secondly, what do you presume you have the powers to do? Almost, what is your entitlement? If you are the Son of God, to what are you entitled as you go about your ministry and your mission? So the first invitation is, well, you're famished, turn these stones into bread. And of course, the thing that's true about all these is the dramatic nature of them. And we see that in parts of the world church today. They attempt to win people over and bring them to the faith through dramatic events. And some of the great gatherings, Pentecostal gatherings, where people are miraculously cured that by being blessed and haven't walked for years, and suddenly they're walking. One can see the attraction of that. I mean, if I could go from here and into the King Edward Hospital and heal those who are ill, think of the effect that we could have. Think of the power that gives me and the influence that would give me. Where people are hungry, just taking what's available. I mean, for Jesus himself, turn all these stones. Well, think of the desert. Turn these stones. There's stones everywhere. It's the invitation to for him to create for himself more materially than he would ever need. And then he's invited, jump off the tower of the temple and God's angels will protect you. Demonstrate how close you are to the power of God. Do we like being close to power? Are those who wield power? Do we like being in the company? Is there an attraction in being in certain types of company? The company of those who have power or status or prestige? Is there an attraction in that? And then finally, he's invited, I'll give you power over all the kingdoms of the world. Political power to rule. And the power, the ability to rule is as he would seem fit for good. But I'll give you that power. You'll have that power over all the nations of the world to rule over them. Well, we've seen where that's got the church in history. And we've seen what happens in nations as well. Because the world is a rebellious world. And when humanity are given the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they eat of that, yes, they become like God. Yes, we become like God. And we, like God, know what is right and what is wrong. But unlike God, we're not able always to do the right. And that's part of the rebelliousness of humankind. Yes, we become godlike, but we can't make the constant choices for right that he would make. And this is what's essentially in this passage. Jesus three times is sort of enticed to, as the Son of God, use the power that surely that gives you. Use the influence that surely that gives you by dramatic episodes. Take that power and rule over the kingdoms of the world. And three times he says, no, no, and no. For that is not the way of God's presence in this world. The rebelliousness of the world, as we read of it in that book of Genesis, the rebellious of the world needs to be taken seriously. It is not indifferent. It is not indifferent to the presence of God in its midst. And the world of Jesus' time was not indifferent to his presence in its midst. It's not indifferent. It's not passive. It opposes it. It opposes all that is represented by the presence of God in our midst. And that's, in a sense, what Jesus is being faced with. The rebellions of the world trying to shift him in a particular direction by using power and status and prestige and drama in that sort of way. And three times, no, no, and no. Because that is not the ways of God. I hope you see how far that is from just being tempted by chocolate or anything else. I mean, this is something really, really quite profound. And that's when I say, have I been particularly tempted? Well, not really in these ways. I've never been offered huge amounts of power. I've never been offered tremendous status or the power to do things. But human beings are. And to be fair, sometimes they use that power, might be political power, sometimes they use that power for good. But just think of the examples when it has been used for ill. And for those who are given these powers, we should especially remember in our prayers, because the way of abusing them and the attraction of using power, if I'm just given the power, I'll sort this, I'll put that right, I'll use the power in a particular way. The attraction of that can be insidious. And always we need to remember Jesus' response to that invitation to use his power in these ways. No, no, and no. And instead, he's starting on his journey of the way to the cross. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. 556, I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. Hymn 556. Let us offer now our prayers of thanksgiving and our prayers for others. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give thanks for all that enriches and enhances our lives at this times, for the love that we receive, for the support in our daily work and life, for the gift of friendship and fellowship, and the communion of your church. Above all, for your constant presence with us. In times of joy and happiness, but in times too of sorrow and of need. And we give thanks for the example of Christ and for his revealing to us of your ways. Not the ways of power as the world would know it, but the ways of humility and service. The ways of love and acceptance and forgiveness and reconciliation. The ways of building community where there is presently exclusion. In his name, we offer our prayers for others. We pray this day for those who wield power in our society and in our world. Men and women, often of good intentions. Sadly, men and women who display only the very rebelliousness of creation and are turning from your ways. But we pray for all who are given the responsibility of using power, that it indeed may be used for the benefit of all, and especially for the most needy and the most vulnerable, that it may be used for peace building rather than division and war, that it may be used to sow happiness and joy instead of sorrow and pain. For the leaders of the nations, we pray. And for all in positions of responsibility in other parts of our societies, those who have the opportunity of influencing, may they always too be guided by the very vision and the priorities of your kingdom, with its values, which so unsettle the ways of the world and indeed our own ways. We pray too for our families and our friends, wherever they may be at this time, and ask your blessing upon them. We pray for our young people as they seek to find their way in the world. May they always know and be comforted and surrounded by love. We pray for those who have grown elderly and frail, the most vulnerable in our society, those in our hospital wards, in our nursing and residential homes. May they always be treated with respect and dignity. And we pray for those whom we know by name and who are in particular need at this time, those receiving or awaiting treatment, those recovering from treatment, and sadly, always those whose illness knows no treatment and no cure. May they and their families be blessed with your peace. We pray for those who are lonely in the midst of others, for those who are anxious and fearful for what the days will bring, for the homeless in our midst, for those struggling financially, economically. And we pray for those who have been bereaved, whether in recent times or in times past, but who live still with that sense of absence. May they be touched by the healing of your Spirit. We remember in our prayers those whose lives are so very different from our own, and who, in a sense, we feel somewhat powerless to help. All those who have lost loved ones through natural disaster in Turkey and Syria. Those caught up in the midst of wars in Ukraine. We pray for a support and the rebuilding and an end of war and of violence. And in this season of Lent, we pray for your church. A time of reflection. Reflection on the life of the church and its history in past years, decades and centuries. And the life of your church in our own time. That we in this congregation and your church in the world may more faithfully reflect your ways. And always we remember with thanksgiving those no longer with us, but whose love we were privileged to receive. May we never think them far from us, for we share a fellowship and a communion with them still through the mystery of that fellowship and communion that we have in you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue our worship with the giving of our offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, in your name we dedicate this, our offering, and the offering of our lives, our time, our talents, our resources, praying that they may be symbols of our commitment to live in your ways and to work for the signs and the growth of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray together now and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hymn 458, At the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. Hymn 458.
In the name of Jesus.
Now go in peace, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love this day and always.